Welcome to Redcliffe, Australia, just outside of Brisbane. And I was passing through this area and somebody asked me if I was going to go to Bee Gees Way. Well, I said, what is Bee Gees Way? And they said, it's a tribute to the famous Bee Gees band. And apparently the Bee Gees originated right here in Australia. Now, I don't know if they originated right here in this town of Redcliffe, but it may be some significance that they have a memorial here, and you can Google that. But I thought that I would just take a moment and do a walk and talk and share this wonderful memory to just a fantastic band. It was a historic band, especially in the time of my youth. And this is the main street here, or one of the main streets, I should say, in Redcliffe. And it's right on the water. In fact, a lot of the towns in Australia are right on the water. And this one is certainly no different. Not a very busy town from what I see. And I'm gonna just walk a little bit here on the main street and give you an idea as to what it might have been like if you were, I don't even know their names, Barry and I know there was, who was the young guy, the heartthrob? I can't remember. But anyway, Andy Gibb, I think, was the, I think Andy Gibb was the heartthrob. So we're just going to do a little bit of a walk and talk, and I'll show you a little bit of the town, and then we'll go for a stroll down Bee Gees Way. So here's the town of Redcliffe, as you can see, and it's certainly not very busy at all. And today is a Monday. It's a Monday afternoon, so that might explain in part why it's not too busy. You see a lot of good old-fashioned fish and chips down here in the land down under. They like their fish and chips, and maybe that is in part because of their British heritage, so to speak. So I'm just going to do a nice little walk, and I'll share the Bee Gees Way with you. I was searching on YouTube, as I sometimes will do when I'm going to do a video such as this, and there didn't seem to be any really great quality, comprehensive videos of this memorial, if you will. I'm not sure if you would call it a memorial, but regardless. So you come in and it's got this arch right here. And then right here, I think, if I'm not mistaken, is the original contract with the Bee Gees, the recording contract. Let's see what it says. The very beginning, Oxley Avenue, Redcliffe. There you have it. An agreement made this 16th day of March 1959 between firm of recording and TV promotions at Brisbane, here and after called the firm, of the first part. Hugh Leslie Gibb and Barbara Mary Gibb, his wife, both of 394 Oxley Avenue, Redcliffe, in the said state, here and after called the parents, of the second part, and Barry Allen Gibb, Robin Hugh Gibb, and Maurice Ernest Gibb, all of 395 Oxley Avenue, Redcliffe, aforesaid, being sons of the said Hugh Leslie Gibb and Barbara Mary Gibb. Well, I'm not going to read the whole thing, but it goes on, whereas the firm has been formed for the purpose of promotion and management in the field of radio, television, recording, theatrical pursuits, and entertainment generally, and whereas the children have in the past performed as an amateur singing trio under the name of, and I can't read that writing there, have also created certain musical compositions, and whereas the children are minors, their birth dates are as follows. And there you have the birth dates of Barry, Robin, and Maurice. And whereas both the children and the parents are desirous of and agreeable to the firm taking over the management and promotion of the children in the general field of entertainment, and whereas the firm is agreeable to so doing. So there you have it, folks. The first time we ever played as a group in public was at the Red Cliff Speedway in 1959. The surprise to me is that it hasn't changed, and that was Barry's words there. Back then, we talked them into letting us sing in between the races, whether it was the Nats or the stock cars. We sang through the PA system on the back of a lorry. The crowd threw money on the track, and we gleefully ran out and picked up the change. We've been doing that ever since. It's as clear to me now as it was then. Race car driver Bill Good and his close friend disc jockey Bill Gates both became aware of our performance. They recognized something in us, the idea that we could be famous. They visited us at our home in Oxley Avenue. We were presented with a guitar with the letters BG stamped on it, and it set us on the path that changed our lives forever. To Bill and Bill, we thank you and salute you. With love, Barry. So let's take a walk here down BG Way. And I'm just going to do this nice and slow and give you just a great opportunity to see this wonderful tribute to this fantastic band. And here's a nice statue of the three brothers. Look at that. And as I'm coming through here, I can hear the music playing, which one would imagine would be appropriate. Look at that. Fantastic. Boy, this really takes me down. This may be Beachy's Way, but for me, it's a little bit of Memories Lane. And I say that because I was growing up outside of Cleveland, Ohio, when the Bee Gees were in all their glory. I think it was Saturday Night Fever was one of their big albums. And my best friend Eric had a sister named Hallie, and Hallie would just adorn her room with pictures of the Gibb brothers, especially Andy Gibb. So as I go down one side of the wall, you see all the murals on the wall. The dichotomy. Always a student and the funniest person I ever knew. His obsession with history was only equaled by his obsession with music. Rob was two people. You never knew who you were gonna get. The extrovert. He was everyone's friend, the magician. He was always keeping children entertained with his bag of tricks. If you ever saw Mo as a child in the schoolyard, there was always a gang of kids running behind him. Like Rob, he could be hysterical, a magnetic personality, never off the stage. And there's the adventurer, spirited and curious. Andy could do anything he set his mind to. If he went water skiing, he didn't need skis. In the last 2 years of his life, he learned to fly, and that tells you a lot, because not everyone has what it takes to be a pilot. Andy seemed to know life was going to be short. That's the instinct you got. So they have the mural of the young Andy Gibb. And there you have the adult Andy Gibb. If I step out here, it'd be kind of nice to go and see if we couldn't find their home here in Red Cliff. Just a quiet little town. Now we'll go down the other side here. The dream came true. The music lives on. The people who listened made it all possible. Fans and friends, forever we love you. There they are at the American Music Awards, International Artists in 1997. Four Brothers United Mythology 2010. Rock and Roll Hall of Fame 1997. Grammy Legend Award. A million copies of Massachusetts 1968. There's a picture of mom and dad, the real Bee Gees. Olivia and Barra fighting Victoria's bushfires in 2009. This is a really nice tribute. Still thinking, still singing to himself, and still being Rob. On a hill in Cumbria. Bee Gees in 2000, anything but white. Fantastic. Immortality with Celine Dion in the late 1990s. There they are with the one and only Michael Jackson. We named him Mickey J. Mo at Home with Adam. Always thinking, always singing to himself. I don't think any of us knew anyone like Rob. Here's the love of my life. We didn't make them, we just wore them, circa 1977. Is it a hit? Andy Gibb, Los Angeles, late 1970s. Catching the Fever, it was called Tribal Rites of a New Saturday Night. Robert Stigwood tapped into this phenomenon and turned it into a film about young people in New York going to clubs and dancing in their own way. It was colorful, it was vivid, it was big hair, it was medallions, it was a decent pair of strides, and we had the time of our lives. We never really knew what was going on outside our storm, but for our family, it was just a joyous time. Looks like they've got some home movies here. Boy, just wonderful. Maurice Beard, Barry Beard, Robin No Beard, but it wasn't their last night. The real Bee Gees, the Bee Gees with parents Hugh and Barbara Gibb, Waldorf Astoria, early 1970s. Boy, this is really a nice thing to come and visit. You're traveling around the world. Every now and then you come across something like this, and it certainly was worth the short effort to come over and see this. There's me and the wife, Barry and Linda, in Miami, 1978. Still looking for tigers, Miami, late 1970s. There they are. Americanization of the Bee Gees. By about 1974, we couldn't get a hit record. It felt like our career was going by the way of many other artists over after 5 years of success. In London, Eric Clapton suggested we come to America, make an album in Miami at a place called 461 Ocean Boulevard. We took his advice, as it had worked for him, and it worked for us. The resulting album was Main Course. We were being influenced by American music in all its different forms. Fantastic. You know, I got to give a big shout out to my favorite Southern Peach, Melissa, who, when she heard that I was coming to Bee Gees Way, she was just thrilled. So, Melissa, I'm dedicating this video to you, all the way over in the beautiful state of Georgia, in the United States. Heading to London in search of fame, we arrived in Southampton and it was very foggy. We wanted some fish and a bag of chips, so they let us off the ship. There was a group standing on the dock identical to the Beatles in Help. They all wore caps and capes and pointed away from the shore and said, "Go home, go home, all groups are out." It was a phrase we heard over and over wherever we went. You have to be an Eric Clapton or you don't stand a chance. We heard this constantly, but we never listened. We'll play anywhere else too. Sydney, 1965. Fantastic. Bee Gees Comedy Trio, Little Egos, Big Shoes, Bandstand, 1963. Larry Moe and Curly Redcliffe, early 1960s. There they are. Still in shorts, Basser, Botting, and Wogie. Redcliffe, 1960. Look at that. I could tell you 100 stories about my life in Redcliffe, swimming every morning off the dock on Deception Bay, fishing for that elusive tiger shark off the Redcliffe Pier at night, playing between the fishing boats when the tide was out, listening to the insects while sleeping beneath the mosey nets, eating fruit from the trees, singing and playing on the beach on those soft, warm summer nights. This incredible place was our world to explore. It held us deeply. It is held deeply within my soul and will always be 1958 for me. The Redcliffe Pier was the main attraction for kids with its pinball arcade. There were many cracks in the pier planks and we would dive for the lost pennies that fell through. The water was clear and blue and provided excellent vision for the best divers. That was us. It was where Robin, Maurice, and I made our first public appearance in Australia through a PA system at the Redcliffe Speedway. People threw money on the racetrack and we met leading DJ and race driver Bill Gates, who suggested we call ourselves the Bee Gees. Hence, Redcliffe became the birthplace of the Bee Gees. I have changed, but the child inside me has not. I am still here on Redcliffe Beach fishing for that tiger shark. I remember vividly my childhood days here, and I will dwell on my Redcliffe for as long as I live. Barry. Fantastic. We found paradise. Gone, gone, childhood days. Gone in so many ways. And all my children, you can see what old acquaintance means to me. The dream is mine, and here it stays, all wrapped up in my childhood days. Old dogs and worn-out shoes. Even children sing the blues. How we must endure it all to save God's creatures, great and small. The dream is mine, and here it stays, all wrapped up in my childhood days. Just wonderful. All right, folks. I really hope you enjoyed this visit here to BG's Way in Redcliffe, Australia. What a real treat. I think I'm going to go do a video of the pier before I head out of town. Have a great day. Thanks for letting me share this with you.